Welcome to the video news of the week. After months of campaigning by a literal army of presidential candidates who crisscrossed the Granite State, on Tuesday, the much-anticipated New Hampshire First in the Nation primary finally took place. On the Republican side, Donald Trump, who we covered during an appearance in Claremont, emerged the victor. The GOP's second place went to Ohio Governor John Kasich, who was the only candidate to visit Dixville Notch, site of the midnight voting during this campaign. On the Democratic side, Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders, seen here during a campaign stop we covered in Berlin, had a decisive win over former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, also seen here, filmed by our cameras during a campaign stop in Berlin. It was here in northern New Hampshire at the stroke of midnight that over 60 journalists gathered to watch the very first votes cast in what is traditionally referred to as the tiny hamlet of Dixville Notch, New Hampshire. Because of renovations underway at the sprawling Balsams Hotel Resort, the voting actually took place in the Hale House on Balsams property nearby. The evening got underway as local Boy Scouts presented the colors in the ballot room and were invited to take part in a mock election.
We were invited by the residents of Dixville in the Balsams to come up here and participate in the First in the Nation primary. They came up with the idea of us doing the flag ceremony and then also doing a mock election to just kind of get a feel for democracy and teach the boys a little bit more about democracy. We are Troop 220, Colebrook, New Hampshire, but we have youth from all over, from Pittsburgh South. They haven't told anyone how they were going to vote. We stayed completely quiet about, and it's our right to exercise our right to vote quietly and vote for the right person. So they did a great job.
We spoke with Les Otten, the Balsams project developer and one of Dixville's newest residents, about the midnight vote.
You know, I feel like a kid. It's very humbling. I mean, it really is. In September of this year is when it really started to hit home that this was actually going to happen. And my daughter called me up and said, Dad, are you going to vote? And I went, what do you mean? She said, well, you know, it's Dixville. You're doing the project. They're going to vote. And it all of a sudden started to come together. And said, well, it's a tradition. We have to keep it going. We have absolutely everything that was in the ballot room. We took it down meticulously. Every photograph, every piece of memorabilia, every piece of tchotchke from that we've got in this building now. And when the ballot room gets rebuilt in the next 2 years, we'll put it back together again.
Among the journalists who came to Dixville was a Danish contingent.
Well, with a group of Danish journalists and politicians and a member of organizations following the primary election here, we came on Wednesday and we are going back the day after the primary tomorrow. In our group are correspondents staying in Washington and New York and so on. So it's a mixed group. Yeah, I think everybody in Europe is very occupied with this election, and Donald Trump is one of the reasons, because he is considered a very odd candidate, very extreme, saying things that offends certain groups in society. So I think it's his phenomenon, which is to be watched, and the same as Bernie Sanders. Maybe it's the modern way of doing politics that you have to be very colorful to gain the voters. The voters of New Hampshire are very serious about it, and they read about it, and they ask a very reasonable questions and get the answers. I think it's a positive experience to see that they really take this election very serious.
Then at the stroke of midnight, town moderator Tom Tillotson announced the polls open, and in a matter of moments, all 9 votes were cast, with 8 voters present and 1 absentee already in the ballot box. The polls were officially closed as crews from CNN, Fox News, and others carried it all live. Then the results were announced.
We have the results. On the Republican side, we have for Donald J. Trump, 2. For John R. Kasich, we have 3. On the Democratic side, we have 4 votes cast for Bernie Sanders.
4 votes cast for Bernie Sanders?
None for Hillary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's it.
So there you have it. There's
there
the results from this.
So,
so there you go, Don. As you can see,
the early morning vote ended with Otten and Tillotson cutting a cake and sharing it with those present to mark the 100th anniversary of the first New Hampshire primary. And with that moment, another Dixville midnight vote, a tradition dating back to 1960, was ready to take its place in the history books. Also on New Hampshire primary day, the nearby unincorporated area of Millsfield was holding a midnight vote. With a population of 29 residents, the locale proudly notes that years ago they preceded Dixville in casting their ballots at midnight.
Back in 1952, we have proof. There is a Time magazine article that details midnight voting in Millsfield, and it quite possibly happened before 52, and we know that it continued after 52 until at least 1960. We have no town hall in Millsfield, no police department, no fire department. They voted in someone's living room just down the road about 2 miles. We're actually doing this at the special request of Secretary of State Bill Gardner. Bill Gardner came to Millsfield, I believe it was a little over 2 years ago, and they were ready to leave, and Mr. Gardner said, well, I got to go to Dixville because they're the first in the nation for midnight voting. And Sonia, who owns the bed and breakfast, said, Mr. Gardner, did you know that long before Dixville even considered doing it, Millsfield was doing midnight voting? And Mr. Gardner is quite a history buff.
Right.
And he was flabbergasted to hear that news. Sonia showed him the Time magazine article that was proof, and right away he said, you folks have to do this again. This is our 100th birthday of the New Hampshire primary, and please, I want you to be part of that celebration, and so it's time for you to do it again. We're going to have a meeting probably soon after this election. We'll all get together and say, okay, what went right, what went wrong, what are the lessons learned, and do we want to do it again in November?
This Wednesday around 6:30 p.m., the Cookshire Eaton Fire Department responded to a structure fire at Lawrence Road in Newport Township. Crews from Sawyerville Station 2, Cookshire Station 1, and Johnville Station 3 were on the scene in a matter of minutes, where they found the house fully engulfed in flames. The residents of the home had safely evacuated, but the house was a total loss. The cause of the blaze was not yet known at press time. Members of Eastern Township's churches gathered for some curling fun at the Lenoxville Curling Rink on Saturday. The Battle of the Churches was a lighthearted competition between 5 area parishes.
Yeah!
On Saturday, the Addo Beaver Park in Lenoxville was the scene of the annual Lenoxville Winter Fun Day. The fun all started at 10 a.m. with games, food, and horse-drawn wagon rides for everyone present. A car show was held in Sherbrooke last weekend featuring popular and exotic models by Ford, Dodge, GM, Rolls-Royce, and more. There was even a DeLorean on hand, as made popular by the film Back to the Future. Doc Brown and Marty McFly even came along for the ride.
New England American folk trio Low Lily performed a coffeehouse concert at the Tillotson Center in Colebrook on Sunday night. The concert was sponsored by the Great North Woods Committee for the Arts.
He holds her in his arms, he holds her in his stare. He holds her hand and runs his fingers through her hair. He'll feel her breath soft on his cheek, she is drifting off to sleep. Thank you.
The Colebrook Chronicle Video News of the Week is sponsored by LaPerle's IGA of Colebrook. Great deals and instant coupons can be found on their website at laperlesiga.com. Colebrook Plumbing and Heating, over 85 years of local dependable service. Call 237-8301 for heating, plumbing, and electrical needs. Murphy's Steakhouse at Bear Tree in Pittsburgh. Enjoy casual fine dining, a cozy atmosphere, and wonderful food. Try the chef's table on Sunday evenings. And by Woodsville Guaranty Savings Bank. Friendly local people, friendly local bank. And open 7 days a week inside Lancaster Shaw's. Friday's temperatures range from a high of 18 degrees to a low of 7. Saturday drops down to a high of 4 and a low of minus 16. And Sunday sinks to a high of 1 with a low of minus 14 degrees. On Saturday night, the Colebrook Mohawks and the Groveton Eagles had an aggressive matchup at the Colebrook Gymnasium. Varsity game against the Pittsburgh Cannon Yellow Jackets on Monday night, Colebrook player Sedrick McKinnon scored his 1,000th career point. Thank you for watching the Video News of the Week.